Guillaume.
Hello, everyone. So yeah, I'm Guillaume, and this presentation is a short story about introducing Scala and functional programming into a big company, a big tech company, which is Criteo. So Criteo, you probably don't know the company. Criteo is a French company, but it's not a global company. We are working in ad tech. And you don't know it probably because we are mainly a B2B company and we don't deal a lot with individuals. But we are actually probably the biggest ad tech company after Google, of course. And we are displaying a lot of ads, annoying ads on your laptop every day. And we are logging tons and tons of events. So that's actually the scale of our data. We have a many big and even giant data center now, Hadoop cluster. We manage something like 100 petabytes of data. We ingest hundreds of terabytes each day. We are running a lot of jobs, MapReduce jobs using Spark, Scalding, Hive. And we are actually now like something like 500 developers, 500 engineers. And so that's the scale of our Paris rooftop, very beautiful, and that's the scale of our vacation. So I usually put that to impress American people, but I guess you guys have kind of the same here, so it's not so bad. So this is a story about introducing functional programming into a company, a big company working mainly with a very good engineer, but mainly with imperative programming background. So the company was started by a couple of guys coming from Microsoft, actually. So from the beginning, everyone was working with C# and .NET and SQL Server. And so no Scala, no functional programming, nothing really fancy, at least on the programming part side, because of course we are doing a lot of not really machine learning, but prediction. And at some point when people wanted to introduce what we consider like better practice, programming practice, like introducing Scala and more functional programming practices into our day-to-day job. Most of the people are actually very suspicious about that. So mostly about performance, because for most developers, performance is a potential program of functional programming, but also about is it useful, will people understand Scala and these new languages. So to give you a better idea, this is actually the typical interview question we ask our candidate on the whiteboard, and this is the preferred answer, right? The official preferred answer. I guess you don't understand what it is doing, so it's finding the anagram into a list of string, and that's actually what it is doing, but in another way. And you have the candidate as bonus point if he finds the hack using the null pointer to indicate that there is many clever hack you can introduce in your code to get bonus point. But basically everyone was happy with .NET and C# and everything. But at some point, our data became very, very big, so it didn't fit in a SQL cluster anymore, even sharded, because you can always, when you get a lot of data, you can always try to shard the data, but at some point when you want to do global analytics, you need a way to query all the data, not only a shard. So someone smart introduced Hadoop at Criteo. And with Hadoop, we get a Hadoop cluster, and a Hadoop cluster, we get thousands of servers, Linux servers this time, running JVM. So it's an opportunity for new software running on the JVM instead of running on Windows and .NET. So because new tooling was necessary to deal with all the data, so of course, when you are working with Hadoop, one of your main day-to-day job is to write MapReduce job in Java. But soon you need more tooling. You need framework, you need scheduler, you need metrology, you need a lot of software around this data. So you start creating your own data, and because you are dealing with JVM, you are doing it in Java. And quickly enough, people started to experiment with better language, with Scala. So mostly with Play, and at some point, with Finatra. So I don't know if you know Finatra, but it is basically the web service component from Twitter. And most of the MapReduce jobs were written with Cascading, which is a Java framework, but Twitter came with Scalding, which is a wrapper, a Scala wrapper on top of Cascading. And so everyone thought that it was better because Cascading API is a lot of verbose. And so new Scala program and project appeared in Criteo. But actually it was not really Scala, it was mostly what we call Scava. So at this time, we had a lot of Scala code, but everything was based on the Twitter stack, which is actually a very good stack. It's very performant, it has a lot of features, very important for a company like us, for monitoring and everything, but it's actually not really Scala. If you look at Finatra and Finagle, the web server component of the Twitter stack, they're actually just a Scala wrapper on top of Java API, so everything is mutable, there is global state everywhere. I mean, it's Scala, but it's just Scala syntax. And the same, they have their own future and everything, so it's a coherent stack, but it's not really Scala. But because you start having this project, you can start saying you can start to hire Scala developer. Scala developer became interested by Criteo because they heard that Criteo does some Scala, so you get a new generation of Scala developer and functional programming developer. So not only Scala, but a lot of guys in France do some Camel as well, and some do some Haskell. So you get new programmer, and this guy want to introduce better Scala practices, so they want to use better library, they don't want to deal anymore with a global mutable shared state and everything. So at this point, we started to introduce a lot of more mature Scala project, and mostly coming from the type level community. So we started quickly with Dubi. So in our group, at least, we are a data group, so we are dealing a lot with database and SQL database. And Dubi was like, wow, super cool library to deal with SQL in Scala. And actually, everyone like Dubi a lot because there is almost no friction using Scala. Even for people coming from Java and not very, they don't really know the hardcore functional programming concept, using Dubi is very easy for them. They just kind of write some SQL and that's all for them from their point of view. And that works well. The same for JSON, so dealing with JSON is also a big part of our job, and we use Circe a lot to do that. We introduced cats more and more in our project too, because actually cats is almost invisible, so you get it for free when you have Dubi or you have Circe anyway. So you have it in your class path and you start using it because you discover that there is this super useful function like dot sequence, dot traverse, dot flat sequence, and that's changed your life because that's just something you always want to do. And after that, you discover that there is more interesting data type like validated, nested, and even eventually at some point you start using MonaTransformer too because it changed a bit your code. And we use FS2 as well, so not directly, but last year we wanted to get a better HTTP stack, so it was beginning of 2017, and we wanted to get a better HTTP stack to deal with the streaming. And so one of the ideas was to put it on top of Netty. We were using Netty internally, and so we created this LOL HTTP client and server Scala library, so it's basically FS2 on top of Netty. And so, but today, since then, HTTP4S did almost the same, so they moved from Scala Z to FS2, and so it's now very close. So there is a lot of catch a lot of problem doing this migration to Scala. So the first one, the most difficult one to solve, is that the tools we use in Criteo don't work anymore when we move to Scala, especially when we move to a good Scala with a good functional programming library that use a macro and a sophisticated type and everything. So mostly one of the most difficult problem to deal with is IntelliJ. So a lot of people need an IDE. They love IntelliJ in Java. It works great for Scala, so they keep using it. But at some point, you introduce, like, even Dubi, for example, you get some red something in your code, and you don't understand why. And you say, oh, Dubi is not so good because, look, it doesn't compile. No, it compiles, it's just that IntelliJ doesn't understand it. It's the same with Scala, with Cats. So you can get a few problems in your IDE. So some people don't really care about it. Okay, there is a few problems in my IDE, but I can work with it anyway. Some people are a bit blocked by that. The same with the debugger. A lot of people like to work with a debugger and to execute the code step by step. Like, so this is the way they work. And when they move to Scala, and especially when they move to Scala with lazy data structure, with I/O, everything, it doesn't work anymore this way. So you can't. And a lot of people are blocked. Like, they try to understand their code, they execute it step by step, and it doesn't work for them. Like, the I/O doesn't do anything, the side effect doesn't execute. It's strange. And for the build too, this is a big problem because we use a monorepo. So this is a most big tech company use a monorepo these days. And we have this monorepo. So monorepo, you say one mono version of Scala, right? But then when you have tons of projects using Scala 2.10 and you want to move to 2.11 using a single version without any cross-build in your monorepo, it means migrating everyone at the same time to Scala 2.11, and actually it's still not done yet, even if you tried since 2 years to do that. So it's super difficult to do that if you don't manage cross-build in Scala properly. Another problem is the split of the Scala community between Scala and Scala for big data. So if you do Scala for Scalding or Spark, it looks like Scala, but it's not really Scala. I mean, you don't have the same set of problems. When I usually use Scala, I'm sure that when it compiles, it's almost okay. And running I just can run it and it works. When I'm doing some big data Scala, compiling it is just super easy, but then running it, it never works. Like, it takes a few weeks to run it on the cluster properly. You have a tons of problems with lambda serialization, a null pointer exception coming from nowhere, class path issue, Hadoop and everything. And so you get a lot of Scala questions that are not actually Scala questions, and Scala problems that are not actually Scala problems, but the framework and Hadoop problem. The old pattern. So people, they really want to use Scala. They come from Java imperative programming. They want to use Scala. But the first thing they ask, okay, that's super cool. So how do I can do this dependency injection thing? Okay. So actually, you don't really need it. Or you have the same problem with Mockito. So I want to use Mockito and it doesn't work this way. So you have to convince people to change their mind. But doing that, you have the same kind of problem the other way. The people looking for new pattern, the new right pattern, and looking, reading a lot of blog posts and finding new super pattern like the cake pattern. Wow, I discovered the cake pattern and I want to push the cake pattern everywhere in everyone Scala code. So yeah, moving from one world to another world, especially Scala, which is very rich, is very difficult. I mean, it let a lot of room for useless discussion about style, how can I do this kind of thing in Scala. So it's very difficult for people. I'm a bit late. Just to say that finally, we are now a real Scala shop because despite all these small problems, a lot of people really like Scala. We have a good tooling now. We have a lot of library and we are doing almost every new development in Scala at Criteo. Every development is done in Scala on Linux, a new development. So we try to contribute back and to open a few open source projects on our GitHub as well. So one of this project is called Soko. So it's a documentation generator. I know there is this Tut project into type level, and it's actually the opposite. So Tut is to include some Scala into Markdown, and this one is to extract your comment into a Markdown component from your code. So it extracts the command, it put it on the left, and it syntax highlights your code into an HTML document, and it puts some pop-up when you can discover the type and link to the Scala doc. The code at the right is actually the code for the an example LOL HTTP server, so it deals with IO, FS2, and everything. Most important Scala project is Scuttle. It is our internal job scheduler, and so it's open source as well. So it's based on Scala. It's actually a distributed Scala job scheduler. You can embed it into your project to schedule jobs. Another Scala project we have open sourced is Slab, is to create a SLA board. So it's one important part of our team to track data SLA, and so we open source this framework based on Scala. And the last one I wanted to show is this Babar. Babar is an Hadoop profiler, and it's a way to track memory, CPU, I/O for your Hadoop cluster, and it's done in Scala as well. So thank you, and I wanted to invite you if you are in Paris in June. We are running this Not Another Big Data conference in Paris, and so we'll have speakers from Spotify, Twitter, Taboola, Datadog, Google, and of course Criteo for one day in Paris about big data. So thank you.